I am back with a brand new session of biology under the heading of plant physiology today. So we are going to start a new chapter under plant physiology, that is photosynthesis. Okay, now you all know that nutrition in plants, that is plants can prepare their own food by the process of photosynthesis. So plants are called as what? Autotrophs. Yes. Now animals depend upon plants directly or indirectly for their food, so they are called as heterotrophs. So these autotrophs are further classified into what are called as the photoautotrophs and chemoautotrophs. Now photoautotrophs means they will make use of the light energy. Yes, and chemoautotrophs means they are going to make use of the chemical reactions which are taking place in the body, like the sulfur bacteria. And nutrition in the plants is always called as holophytic nutrition, means they will take in raw materials always as say liquids or gases, but never solids. Okay, so just let us have a look here. Nutrition. Plants can prepare food for themselves by the process of photosynthesis. So we are going to discuss in detail this process of photosynthesis. Hence they are called as autotrophs. Auto means self and troph means nutrition. So autotrophs. Now autotrophs are further classified into photoautotrophs, that is they prepare food in presence of sunlight. And second is chemoautotrophs, that is use energy from chemical reactions like sulfur bacteria. And nutrition in plants is holophytic, as they take in raw materials in form of liquids or gases but never solids. Animals depend on plants directly or indirectly for the food, hence they are called as heterotrophs. Now we'll have a look at the next part. So as you can see, photosynthesis is an anabolic process in which living plant cells containing chlorophyll produce food substances, that is glucose and starch, using carbon dioxide and water in presence of light energy. Okay, so definition of photosynthesis is important. It's an anabolic process. What do you mean by anabolic? Yes, very good. Constructive process. Yes, it's the formation of something. And respiration is catabolic, breakdown. Yes, so you should remember that. So photosynthesis is an anabolic process in which living plant cells containing chlorophyll will produce the food substances in form of glucose and starch from carbon dioxide and water in presence of sunlight. Now oxygen is released as a byproduct of this process. So the overall reaction is also very important. Now what is the importance of this process, photosynthesis? Now it is forming the basis for life. It is responsible for release of oxygen and prevention of air pollution. Now photosynthesis forms the basis of life because it is providing food substances to all plants also as well as the animals. So animals directly or indirectly also will depend upon this process. Now it is the only process in which oxygen is released as a byproduct and prevention of air pollution. Now because it is consuming carbon dioxide, so the carbon dioxide which is generated in the atmosphere due to pollution, vehicular emissions, etc., all that is being utilized by the plants, yes, in this process of photosynthesis, and in return it is giving out oxygen. So that is the uses of the photosynthesis. So now definition. Now definition is very important. You give 5 stars to the definition. Many times you are asked to explain the term photosynthesis or define photosynthesis. So photosynthesis is an anabolic process in which living plant cells containing chlorophyll produce food substances, that is glucose and starch, from carbon dioxide and water by using light energy. And oxygen is produced as a byproduct of the photosynthetic process. This is your definition. Equation very, very important. 6CO2 plus 12H2O. On the arrow you have to write chlorophyll and sunlight. Gives C6H12O6, that's glucose, plus 6H2O plus 6O2. Okay, so definition and the reaction. Now importance of photosynthesis also is 5 stars. Many times you are asked give any 2 aspects for the importance of photosynthesis. So photosynthesis is the basis of life, provides food for all living organisms. Animals also depend on plants for their food. Second, release of oxygen. Oxygen is a byproduct and supports all life on earth. Third, prevention of air pollution. Photosynthesis helps to keep the carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere constant. Carbon dioxide released during respiration by living organisms and other processes like burning of coal, wood, fossil fuels, etc. is used during photosynthesis, thus preventing air pollution. Okay, is it clear? Now we'll move to the next part. Okay, now let us see what raw materials are required for photosynthesis. Now we saw in the reaction that carbon dioxide and water is there in the reactant side. So carbon dioxide will be taken from the atmosphere, and by the process of diffusion it will be entering through the open stomata. Now water is absorbed by the process of osmosis, is from the roots with the help of osmosis, and to be taken in the upward manner and distributed to all parts of the plant. Now light energy, that is the sunlight, solar energy is used, and the unit of light which is absorbed is the photon. And chlorophyll is the green pigment which is present in the chloroplast. Okay, so these are the raw materials which are required. Now just look at this diagram. Draw a neat labeled diagram of the chloroplast as seen under electron microscope. Now this is an important diagram, and give 5 stars to this diagram. You have to draw this in the notebook. Now we said that chlorophyll is the green pigment which is found in the chloroplast. Now these chloroplasts, now what is the location of these chloroplasts? Where do you find the chloroplast? Now the chloroplasts are generally found in the palisade and the spongy mesophyll of the leaf. I hope you remember in transpiration we had discussed this in the transfer section of the leaf, that is the spongy mesophyll and the palisade mesophyll of the leaf shows chloroplast, and it is also present in the guard cells is surrounding the stoma. So that is the location of the chloroplast. Now average a cell may have around 50 to 60 chloroplasts, and they can be as many as 5 lakh chloroplasts per square millimeter of the leaf surface. Okay, now if you see the structure of the chloroplast, it is an oval shaped organelle, and it is having double membrane. So it has an outer membrane and an inner membrane. Now the space between these membranes is called as the periplastidial space. Okay, this is the space between the membranes called as the periplastidial space. Now it encloses a colorless ground substance. All this ground, this background is the colorless ground substance called the stroma. Stroma matrix also it is called, that is the ground fluid. Now embedded in this stoma are many coin like structures. You can see these stacks here. So a single coin is called as the thylakoid, flattened sac. A single coil is called as the thylakoid, and this entire stack or the pile of thylakoids is called as the grana. Yes, granum for singular and plural is grana. So this pile of thylakoids is the grana. Single coin like structure is thylakoid. Now each grana is the, or each granum is connected to each other by these thread like structures. These are called as the stroma lamellae or the fret membrane. Okay, so stroma lamellae or the fret membrane will connect the grana. This entire stack is the grana, and one single coin like structure is the thylakoid. Is the explanation part of the structure clear? Yes. Now where is this chlorophyll which we said actually present? It is present in the walls of the thylakoid. So exact location of the chlorophyll, if we see, it is present in the walls of the thylakoid. Now the chlorophyll is a highly complex molecule. Yes, it is made up of carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, hydrogen, and the inorganic component present in chlorophyll is magnesium. This you should remember. Many times you are asked the inorganic component of chlorophyll is what, like, so it is magnesium, remember it. Yes, and there are almost say 9 different types of chlorophyll, and out of that chlorophyll A and B are most abundant. Now you have to understand that the chlorophyll absorbs the light energy and gets activated. Now we'll see in the process of photosynthesis, the first step is activation of chlorophyll. So this chlorophyll is absorbing the light energy and it is initiating the process of photosynthesis. And why this chlorophyll appears green in color, that is also asked many times, because it absorbs light at the two ends of the visible spectrum, that is the blue and the red light, and it reflects the green light, so it appears green in color. Okay, is it clear? So here what you are supposed to remember is the location of the chloroplast. They are located in the palisade and the spongy mesophyll of the leaf and in the guard cells surrounding the stoma. And location of the chlorophyll is important. It is present in the walls of the thylakoid in the chloroplast of the leaf. You can't just write chlorophyll leaf, okay, you will get zero then. So, and diagram is important. Draw a neat labeled diagram of the chloroplast as seen under electron microscope. Okay, is it clear? Now we'll see the next part. Now we'll see the regulation of the opening and closing of the stomata. Yes, because through the open stomata only the carbon dioxide is going to enter. Now if you remember in transpiration chapter, we have already discussed the regulation of the opening and closing of the stomata and the sugar concentration theory. And diagram also you have drawn. Okay, but you will draw the diagram again because it is an important diagram. So you have to draw the diagram again. Now you know that the stomatal pore, now this is the stomatal pore, is surrounded by the bean shaped guard cells. Okay, this is the stomatal pore and it is surrounded by these bean shaped guard cells, and these are the epidermal cells. Now the guard cells, if you observe, they have a thick inner lining. The inner wall is very thick and the outer wall is comparatively thinner. Is that facilitates for it to hold the water and become turgid. And also present in the guard cells are the chloroplasts. So these are the chloroplasts, we had already labeled them. So these are the chloroplasts present in the guard cells. So these two aspects, that is thick inner wall and a thin outer wall, and presence of guard cells, help in the opening and closing of the stomata. Now what are the two theories which have been proposed? One is the potassium ion theory and other is the sugar concentration theory. The second one we have already discussed in transpiration. We'll see what is this potassium ion theory. Now according to this theory, now because the chloroplasts present in the guard cells are capable of carrying out photosynthesis during daytime, energy is generated in form of ATP as a result of photosynthesis. So this ATP energy will be used to pump the potassium ions from the neighboring epidermal cells into the guard cells. So there will be an inward movement of the potassium ions into the guard cells. So what will happen? The concentration of the guard cells will increase. It will become what? Hypertonic due to potassium ions. So because it becomes hypertonic, there will be inward movement of water from the neighboring epidermal cells, because this is concentrated and outside it is dilute. So water will move from the guard cells from the epidermal cells into the guard cells. Inward movement will take place and thereby the guard cells will become turgid and thereby the stomatal pore will open. Okay, that is the potassium ion theory. And other was the sugar concentration theory. Again, here you have to remember that the chloroplasts present in the guard cells carry out photosynthesis, and because of that the sugar concentration, glucose concentration in the guard cells will increase. So it becomes hypertonic and water from the neighboring epidermal cells will rush in by osmosis, thereby making the guard cells turgid. Okay, so these are the two theories. Now out of that, only this potassium ion theory you have to remember. Sugar concentration we have discussed earlier, but as the scope of syllabus says, sugar concentration you don't have to know in photosynthesis. Okay, now potassium ion theory is asked in this manner, that's why I have written this as a question here. Give 5 stars to this question. Complete the following paragraph using the suitable words. Stomatal opening and closing depends on the generation of potassium ion gradient, that is the blank. During daytime, the chloroplasts in the guard cells photosynthesize, which leads to the production of ATP. So these are the blanks which you have to remember. This is used to actively pump the potassium ions of the adjacent cells into the guard cells, making them hypertonic. This draws more water from the adjacent cells and the guard cells become more turgid, thus opening the stomatal pore. Okay, is it clear? So this is the theory for regulating the opening and closing of the stomata. Now we want the stomata to be open, so through the open stomata the carbon dioxide is going to enter in, which is our raw material for photosynthesis. Okay, now we'll have a look at the next part. Okay, now let us see the mechanism of photosynthesis. Now, the process of photosynthesis is an oxidation reduction process which results in the oxidation of water and reduction of carbon dioxide. Now, the main two phases of photosynthesis are light reaction or light dependent reaction, also called as the photochemical phase, and the other is the light independent reaction or the biosynthetic phase. So, two main phases are there. First, light dependent phase or photochemical phase, or it is also called as just light reaction also. Okay, now why it is called as photochemical phase? Because a number of chemical reactions occur in quick succession initiated by light. You need light to initiate that process. So, it is called as a photochemical phase. And what is the site of action of this? It takes place in the thylakoids. Thylakoids, which is containing the chlorophyll. Now, even if you mention grana, it is fine. Thylakoids or grana is where the is the site of the light reaction. Now, this takes place in a further two steps. First step is called as the activation of the chlorophyll. Now, the chlorophyll on exposure to the light energy will get activated and will initiate the process by the absorbing of the photons. And second step is the splitting of water molecule. The activated chlorophyll will cause the splitting of the water molecule. That process is called as photolysis. Photo is light and lysis is breakdown. So, it will cause the splitting of the water molecule to form hydrogen ions, electrons and oxygen. Okay, that is photolysis. And because it is taking place in presence of light, it is called photo, and lysis is breakdown. So, photolysis. Now, just let us see this. So, light dependent phase is also called as the photochemical phase. And the second phase is what called what? Light independent phase, which we will see shortly. Now, a series of chemical reactions occur in very quick succession, initiated by light. Hence, the phase is called photochemical phase. Okay, so sometimes you can be asked the reason. So, important. Now, light reaction takes place in the thylakoids containing chlorophyll of the chloroplast in two main steps. These are the two main steps. First, activation of chlorophyll. Chlorophyll on exposure to the light energy becomes activated by absorbing photons, which is the smallest unit of light energy. And second is the splitting of water molecule. The light energy absorbed by the chlorophyll splits the water molecule into hydrogen and oxygen with the release of electrons. Now, this equation is important. Two molecules of water, energy of four photons will give four hydrogen ions, four electrons and 2O. This is not 20. Yes, please note, this is not 20. This is 2 oxygen. Two atoms of oxygen. Okay. Now, this reaction is known as photolysis, which means splitting by light. Photo means light and lysis means breaking. Okay. Now, we have to see what is the fate of these products of photolysis. So, that we'll see in the next part. Okay. Now, here we are seeing the fate of the result of the products of photolysis. Yes, end result of photolysis. Now, the hydrogen ions, as you can see here, these hydrogen ions are picked up by a compound called NADP. Now, full form of NADP is very, very important. It's nicotinamide, adenine, dinucleotide, phosphate, NADP. So, the hydrogen ions are picked up by a compound NADP to form NADPH. Yes, nicotinamide, adenine, dinucleotide, phosphate. Yes, so this is the reaction. NADP plus electrons plus H in presence of enzymes will give you NADPH. Now, this 2 oxygen, the oxygen component is given out as molecular oxygen. Yes, this is the fate of oxygen. And the electrons are used in converting ADP. ADP is adenosine diphosphate into energy-rich ATP, adenosine triphosphate, by adding an inorganic phosphate group. Now, this process of formation of ATP is called phosphorylation. Yes, and since we are carrying this out in presence of sunlight, it is called as photophosphorylation. So, just try to understand this phosphorylation, very, very important. The process of formation of ATP from ADP by the addition of an inorganic phosphate is called phosphorylation. And because it is taking place in presence of light, it is called as photophosphorylation. Now, why we have to specify here photo? Because in respiration also ATP is produced. But there now you are not using light energy. So there it becomes oxidative phosphorylation. That is why the difference, photophosphorylation and oxidative phosphorylation. Now here I have written one question, define photolysis. Now this is again important. So photolysis is defined as a splitting of water molecules into hydrogen and oxygen with the release of electrons in presence of light and grana. And this is the equation. Now, end result of the products of photolysis, hydrogen ions are picked up by compound NADP to form NADPH, oxygen component given out as molecular oxygen, and electrons are used in converting ADP, adenosine diphosphate, into energy-rich ATP by adding one phosphate group. This process is called phosphorylation, and since energy is used is coming from light, it is called as photophosphorylation. So this completes our the first stage, that is the light dependent phase or the photochemical phase. Now we will have a look in the next slide, the light independent phase. Okay, now the second phase is the light independent phase. Now this light independent phase is also called as the biosynthetic phase. Now actually it does not require light, so it is written as light independent phase. Now in the earlier this phase was also called as the dark phase. Now you should not call it as a dark phase because it's not that it takes place in the dark. Actually it takes place almost simultaneously with the light reaction with a time gap of less than around 1/1000th of a second. So whatever are the products of the light reaction, what were the products of the light reaction? ATP, oxygen and NADPH. Those will be utilized in this light independent phase, because if you saw in the light reaction, nowhere carbon dioxide played a role. So carbon dioxide will play a role in this light independent phase. So the carbon dioxide will combine with that NADPH and the ATP and ultimately will form glucose. Now you don't have the details of this light independent phase, only what I have written here, only that much is there as per the syllabus. Okay, so you have to know that this phase occurs in the stroma of the chloroplast. Where was light reaction occurring? In the grana or thylakoids. Yes, very good. So this is taking place in the stroma of the chloroplast. The reactions in this phase do not require light energy and occur simultaneously with the light reaction with a time gap of less than 1/1000th of a second. Hydrogen of the NADPH gets combined with carbon dioxide by utilizing ATP energy to ultimately produce glucose. So end products are glucose. Yes. Now this glucose which is produced, so immediate product of photosynthesis, immediate product of photosynthesis is glucose. Okay. Now all the glucose will not be utilized by the plant. So whatever is utilized will get absorbed and the rest gets converted into starch. So the process of formation of several molecules of glucose to one molecule of starch is called as polymerization. Okay. So that term polymerization is important. Now some plants will change glucose to sucrose, that is cane sugar, which chemically is called as a disaccharide. Okay, is it clear? So with that we complete the process of photosynthesis. We saw the process of photosynthesis or the mechanism of photosynthesis. Main is the two reactions which you have to know. One is the light dependent reaction, photochemical phase, and second is the light independent reaction or the biosynthetic phase. So what are the products required, what are the raw materials, then the site of the reaction, all that is very important. Okay, so we'll continue with the same chapter in the next session with respect to the factors and some experiments on photosynthesis. Till then you complete all these notes properly. Stay healthy and happy in the house. Okay, thank you.